Good morning. My name is D.J. Reed, and I'm the pastor of Chilson Hills Church. We are located at 4440 Brighton Road in Howell, and we also can be found on the web at chilsonhills.org, and I hope that you'll check that out, and you'll find out more about our congregation and what makes us unique. If you were with us this morning, we would invite you to come and gather with us around the Lord's table, or as it's called, communion in other congregations. This is a special time, a time in which we observe and we remember what Jesus has done for us. We remember this time when Jesus gathered his close followers together, and he took a loaf of bread and a cup of wine, and he took that loaf of bread and he broke it, and he said, "This is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And then he took that cup and he gave it to his disciples and he said, "This represents a new relationship, the new covenant in my blood. Do this also in remembrance of me." And with that, we had new symbols for what it meant to be in a relationship with God, that our relationship was made right with God because of what Jesus did for us. We want to invite you to gather together with whoever you're with, whether you're by yourself or whether you're with your family or your friends. Get some bread or maybe some crackers. Get some cups of juice or some wine. And while this next song is playing, I invite you to share those crackers or those pieces of bread with whomever you're with, or just enjoy it yourself. And as you do so, say out loud, "The body of Christ that's broken for you, and the blood of Christ that's shed for you." Let that be a reminder of how much Jesus loves you and how he gave himself up for you. Would you join me in a word of prayer? God, we thank you for what you have done for each one of us. Today, God, we are mindful of many who are sick, and many who are hurting, and many who are mourning. And God, we believe that you are present with us here today. This bread and this cup reminds us that you are present with us. And I pray, God, that for those who are strong and those who are well, that we would not stop praying for those who are sick, and that you would use our health, you would use our strength to be a blessing to other people. God, you have called each one of us to ministry, and I pray that you would help us do that today. In your name we pray, amen.
over to Bob and Jackie Dietz's house first.
You look great. You look fantastic. Keeping it real here.
They don't have a job. Don't pay your bills.
Here we go.
Won't buy you a home in Beverly Hills.
We'll go. Hey, now wave at me. Hey, Carol. Hey, how are you?
We'll fix your life in 5 easy steps. Ain't the love of the land for the government.
Taking a selfie. Social distancing.
But it's all you need.
Hi.
In love.
Hi.
Well, hold us together. Make us a shelter. Weather the storm. And now be my brother's keeper. So the whole world will know that we're not.
Last week, we began a sermon series on the book of Acts, which is the fifth book of the New Testament of the Bible, and it follows the four Gospels, which tell the story of Jesus and his life and his death and his resurrection. And we talked last week how the early church began in this small room right there at the beginning of Acts. We read about how they gathered together, and there Jesus trained them and taught them and prepared them for ministry, and then Jesus left them, and the disciples came back to that room. And they were prepared further for ministry that would take place after that. And I imagine that the disciples felt a lot like how we felt. We felt how we feel right now, just being cooped up in our homes and preparing for who knows what is going to be in the future. Thank goodness for windows, right? Those windows, while they provide protection from the elements, they also allow us to see the world around us. It allows us to see the slowly greening grass outside of in our yards, and it allows us to see the tree buds beginning to take shape. It allows us to see our neighbors walk around the neighborhood, and it allows us to see just the world around us. Windows are like a metaphor for how we live how we live our life. Windows can be seen as a metaphor for a new perspective to the world. Today we're going to be talking about one man who had a window opened up for him, how he was able to see Jesus, how he was able to see the world in a whole new way because of an encounter he had with two of Jesus' disciples. So here is the scripture passage from the book of Acts.
The scripture for this morning is Acts 3, 1 through 9. One day Peter and John were going up to the temple. It was 3 o'clock in the afternoon. It was the time for prayer. A man unable to walk was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful. He had been that way ever since he was born. Every day someone put him at the gate. There he would beg from people going into the temple courtyards. He saw that Peter and John were about to enter, so he asked them for money. Peter looked straight at him, so did John. Then Peter said, "Look at us." So the man watched them closely. He expected to get something from them. Peter said, "I don't have any silver or gold, but I'll give you what I do have. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, get up and walk." Then Peter took him by the right hand and helped him up. At once the man's feet and ankles became strong. He jumped to his feet and began to walk. He went with Peter and John into the temple courtyards. He walked and jumped and praised God. All the people saw him walking and praising God. May God bless the reading and the hearing of God's holy word.
So we find Peter and John going to the temple to pray. This was probably something that they did every day. And as they were going this time, they encountered a beggar. Again, something probably not unusual for them. And this beggar had been placed there by family or friends. And he had been placed there because he couldn't walk. He couldn't work, couldn't make any income. And so what he felt like he needed money. He needed income. And so he was asking anyone who would come by for any kind of change, any kind of money that would be able to support him. That's what he felt like he needed. Now, I have needs in my life, certainly not like this man's, but I have needs in my life. And a lot of times where I look for those needs are in pretty shallow places. I think the place that I tend to go to the most is the web. I go to the internet and I go there and I look for some kind of an answer. I go to Google, right? I go to Google and I search for a solution, something, an answer to my question, or I look for a product on Amazon, or I look for something that is going to help me out. Those are my needs. And you probably understand what I'm talking about. I think you have certain things that you are looking for. And the problem is that sometimes we are looking for things in the wrong places. We're looking for answers to our questions, or we're looking for satisfaction to the things that we feel like we need in the wrong places. And so we look endlessly for the right answer in news sources or information sources. We look all over the place for some religious figure, some politician, some professional, some doctor, a scientist that will confirm what we hope is true or what we truly feel like we need. The Bible is full of stories of people who are searching for and are in need of something. And when we read back in the Old Testament, we read about the very first temple that was created, the temple that was built by Solomon, considered to be one of Israel's greatest kings. And after he had finished building the temple, God came to Solomon and said, "I am very much in favor. I love this place. This place, my eyes and my heart will be here." But then he warns Solomon. He says, when times are bad, times are really hard, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I will hear them from heaven and I will forgive their sins and I will heal their land. God wants our attention during times of need. We think that we need extra income or money. We think that we need whatever we're asking for, whatever we're searching for. But God wants our attention. God wants us to trust him. And so we are searching, looking through whatever windows we can, whether they be the windows at our home or the windows in our computer screen, searching for the right answer. And what God is saying is, look at me. And we read about this in the book of Acts, in the passage that was just read for you. Peter and John come across this man who can't walk, and they look at the man and they say, look at us. Look at us. And the man looks at them, and Peter and John say to him, listen, we don't have silver or gold. We don't have any money. But what we do have for you is this. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, rise up and walk. Rise up and walk. Jesus, you see, is the window to God's heart. Is the window to God. If you want to know what God is like, you'll look at Jesus. And the disciples knew this. The disciples knew they themselves were windows to Jesus, that they weren't, while they asked the man who could not walk, the beggar, they said, look at us. They were not saying, look at us so that you can see how heroic or how much power we have. Instead, look at us as if we are windows to Jesus, as if we reflect Jesus's character and who he is. By our lives and by our actions, by what we show and what we do, we are reflecting Jesus. We are windows to Jesus, and Jesus is a window to God. I always remember Mr. Rogers saying one time that if you want to find hope in this world, look to the helpers. He begged news programs to stop focusing on the negative and instead for just to dedicate a certain portion of their programming to watching the helpers. And I'm sure that some of you have noticed the heroic efforts of those who are our first responders and those who are in our healthcare industry, who are working in our hospitals, that are helping people on a daily basis without thought for themselves. And by watching them, what we are essentially doing is we are getting just a window into the character of Christ. Because through their sacrifice, we can see how we can get just a taste of how Jesus loved us, how he gave himself up for us. I want to show you just a short drama about a window and how one man use that window to help another man in great need.
So what is he doing now?
He's down on one knee, handing her flowers.
She doesn't want flowers. She wants a ring.
That's what he's afraid of. Now, wait a minute. She just threw all the flowers in the ground and stormed off.
She wants a ring.
He's going after her. Forget it, kid. She's gone.
Hey, you know, if it wasn't for you telling me what's going on in that park, I don't know what I'd do.
I enjoy it.
You made me realize that there's plenty to enjoy without having to see it. Thanks.
Forget about it. Eat your lunch. Guess who's sitting on the bench holding the flowers?
You're kidding.
I kid you not.
Well, what's he doing?
He's standing up, She's back. She's
what?
She's taking the flowers. And...
and what?
And she's giving him a big kiss. Oh, he's back down on one knee again.
Uh-oh.
But this time, he's got something else.
A ring? Yep.
You got it.
Way to go, kid.
Murray, are you ready?
Am I ready? Who can ever be ready for something like this?
I know, but it is time.
Well, if it's time, then it's time.
Good luck, my friend. Only one tray?
He didn't make it.
Nurse. Will you do me a favor, please? Would you take a look down at that park and tell me what you see?
Mr. Johnson, there's nothing outside this window but a brick wall.
Are you looking through? What people are you looking to for help? If you feel helpless and you feel hopeless, if you feel like you're at the end of your rope, you feel like you're about ready to snap, if you feel like you just can't take it anymore, I would just encourage you to reach out to Jesus. That may not be the answer you were looking for. That may not be what you were hoping to find when you started watching this video here today. That answer may feel really trite and really easy. But I just want to repeat what Peter and John said to the beggar who felt like he needed just a few coins. Listen, we don't have what you're looking for. We ourselves can't give it to you. But what we can give you is we can give you access to Jesus. We can be the window to Jesus. If you look at us, we'll point you to Jesus. Not because we're perfect, not because we've got everything down, not because we've got all the answers that you need, but just because Jesus has done something in our lives, because Jesus has changed us. And because of that, we feel honored and privileged to be windows for this person that we call our Savior. For those of you who know Jesus, I would ask you to consider your life and how you're living. Through your actions and through your words, are you serving as effective windows for Jesus? Are your actions reflecting Jesus' love and his kindness and his compassion? Are your words spreading peace and love? Are you a planter of joy to the people around you? Are you yourselves windows into the heart of God, to the character of Jesus? I would ask all of you and submit that challenge to all of you this week to think of your lives as being windows to Jesus, letting the world see Jesus through what you do and what you say. Would you pray with me? God, you have given us so much. God, in a world that is just filled with chaos right now, in a world that is filled with so much mystery right now, where we can't plan ahead and we can't map out our next step, Lord, we need people, we need windows who can show us hope. And I pray, God, that you would put those people in our lives. And I pray that you would help us to be those kind of windows as well. That we would show other people through our lives that you are alive and that there is kindness and there is goodness in this world and there is a reason to hope. And with that we say, amen. Well, I hope you enjoyed this video today. And I hope that you'll also check us out on the web at chilsonhills.org. If you are brand new to our church, please make sure you check out our visitor center. There you can find an online form that you can fill out. And then that will get back to me and then I can get in touch with you. And that just gives you an opportunity to ask any questions about what our congregation is about and what kind of activities we offer. We do have a church calendar. We are still active as a congregation. We are getting together via Zoom through Bible studies, weekly church meetings. We have a mom's group. We have a group that is talking about the Apostles' Creed right now. We've got a kids club that meets on Saturday mornings. There's lots of different things that are going on. And so if you're interested, make sure you check out that that calendar. You can also send me an email with more information, if you have any questions, at djreed@chilsonhills.org. You can also text us. Text the word welcome to 810-285-7769. And that will get you into our system. And we send out weekly text messages to let people know, keeps them up to date with what's going on in our church. We also send out e-newsletters. And so again, that number is 810-285-7769. If you would like prayer, we do have a webpage on our site. Go to chilsonhills.org/prayer, and there you can fill out an online form that is submitted to a team of prayer volunteers who are committed to praying for people in our congregation and our community. And those prayer requests will be kept strictly confidential. And so just want you to know about that as well. We are a functioning congregation and we are supporting staff and we are doing ministry in our community. So if you would like to support us, we would be grateful for that. You can do that by going to chilsonhills.org/give, and that will and you can make a quick, secure, online, easy donation there on our website. With that in mind, I want to close today with a benediction, a blessing for all of you. My brothers and sisters, it is important for you to remember who you are. You are sons and daughters of God. You are friends and disciples of the Lord Christ Jesus. And the love and the joy and the peace and the power of God is at loose in the world through your lives. Go now and live, because that is true. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, amen. Go in peace to serve the Lord.